Good evening. Hello, how's everyone feeling tonight? My name is Maya Jupiter.
My name is Aloe Blacc.
Thank you, everyone, and just, you know, what a real honor and pleasure to be here with you this evening. This is our wonderful band, Farmer, Woody, and Evan behind us. Sharing some thoughts with you, but I always want to start off by acknowledging the traditional owners or caretakers of the land that we gather here on today, the Tongva people, and of course all the way out to the coast, the Chumash, and whose land we are on. Sovereignty was never ceded. This is Tongva land, always was and always will be.
Remember that? I do remember that.
Yeah, because usually I'm, you know, trying to tell a story or whatever, and the idea of truth, like divine truth. What does that mean? And then these lyrics just started flowing out, and the second and the third verse actually describes, the first verse describes the flag, so I'm half Turkish, half Mexican, so it's a crescent moon and a star, and the third verse starts with the imagery of a Mexican flag, which is snap on a serpent, and the eyes of an eagle perched on a cactus, snap on a serpent, fruit that nurtures. So it's sort of pulling from my own ancestry, identity, and mixing that all in.
Right, and I guess, you know, as artists, finding pieces of our ancestry, of our heritage, helps us to create, and we can draw from it to inspire us. But in a song like I Am, musically, how do you feel that the song also represents you in terms of the instrumentation or the sound of the vibe?
I think I've always pulled from my Mexican heritage for rhythm. So this song heavily features the rhythm of Son Jarocho, which is a rhythm over 300 years old from the state of Veracruz. In Veracruz in Mexico is the place closest to the Caribbean side. It's closest to where we had, you know, Africans there, Arabs there. So it's a mix of indigenous, Spanish, Arabic, and African culture. And if you know La Bamba, then you know Son Jarocho. And so the song, you know, I love that kind of bringing that tradition into hip-hop. I've always been hip-hop and writing since I was 14. And I was always saying, you know, my culture is hip-hop. Growing up in Australia, I'm coming from Sydney. That's what I identify as. But I always love to bring in cultural identity. Now, here talking about mental health. So I know that art is a way for us to always, for me especially, to process thoughts, emotions, especially going through hard times. Since I was a teenager, I would write. That's what I would do, is whenever something was going on, I would just take a pen and start writing. What are your influences when you write? Where do you get inspiration from?
Inspiration is absolutely, it's coming from maybe some of the stress that can be in my life. Of course, you know, being in the music industry, there's the pressures of business, there's pressures of, you know, my own kind of barometer for success, and then there's pressures from my peers and just feeling like I'm not leaving my peers cast aside. You know, I came up from the underground, hip-hop music, and then started singing soul music, and then started doing pop music, and every once in a while I feel that pull, that tension that is saying you're straying a bit too far away from the homies. Like, you gotta, you know, bring the reins back in.
How do you keep your, industry, because you've been signed to a major label, so how do you stay true to who you are and balance that with what people want, what they say that people want. You know what I mean?
I wait till you tell me as
that's true.
We're married, by the way, that's why we're talking. In case it's like, why are you talking?
Do people not know?
I don't know.
Oh my God. 9 years.
I was able to get in the music business, start at a young age, but in my own terms, on my own terms. And then when I got signed to a major label, I was 30 already. So there wasn't a whole lot of the pressure to change coming from the top down. I already knew who I was, but that happens to a lot of young folks who come in, and then I had a great network and a great community around me. That's the one thing I wanted to mention about with the song like I Am that you just performed. That was one of the first songs you wrote when you came here to the United States. So you had an entire life that you left in Australia and you're trying to plant roots here. maybe you can talk a little bit later about how it felt emotionally, the struggle of just being in a brand new place with no family and making new friends.
One thing, we walked in the gallery earlier, and one thing that really struck me, even though I need to go back and spend more time looking at each art piece because it's just phenomenal, but was the intersections of everything. It was like, oh wow, this is all connected, you know, and that all the struggles, whether it's just getting out of prison, or it's living on a reservation, or it's being a single mom, or whatever it is, it's all connected and affects our mental health. So that really struck me. But I wanted to ask you about SOS. I know that this is a song that Avicii wrote, but how do you connect with that message and relate it to what you see as an artist in that world that we're not privy to?
Yeah. Okay, so the backstory. I released a song about a month ago called SOS. I'm a featured artist on a collaborative song with a producer, DJ artist by the name of Avicii, who passed away last year, April 20th. He took his own life. And he had very well-documented stress and battles within the music industry. And this particular song, unbeknownst to me, was written and I was slated to sing it. I didn't find out until January. But when I read the lyrics, I was floored because it's called SOS, and it really is a call for help. And in a lot of ways, you know, it's a bittersweet victory to be able to release the music in honor of my friend, but I'd rather it not be a song on the radio right now. I'd rather it just be here and have really made an SOS in a real way to all the people around me. But one of the things he's left us with, his fans and myself, is this new purpose to sing the song, to share the story, to fly the flag of mental health awareness and helping the people who need help and checking in on your friends and your family as often as possible, because they need it and they're not going to tell you. You know? So I'm going to sing this song, SOS.
letter. So if anyone felt moved or needed to speak, I think that's just really brilliant. That there's support here right now.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that struck me with Avicii's death and with this particular song, the lyric is that, like I said, you know, sometimes the people who need the most help are the best at hiding, and trying to find ways to be a stand for and to be present and to be available for, you know, our friends who are most vulnerable, and having a network and a community is important. And you know, within Avicii's network, I don't know where I sat. I kind of maybe was somewhere in one of the outer rings of Saturn, but I feel like, you know, I always go through my mind, like, could I have been there more? Could I have emailed more, called more? Could I have said something? Could I have offered help in a different way? The answer is yes, I could have. And for me, the instruction now is to be proactive and to reach out. And so, you know, today I made a phone call to a friend that I know for sure is dealing with depression and issues, and you know, he's had really traumatic experiences in his life, and I felt like it's my opportunity, knowing what I know now, that it was time to reach out and be there.
I also, I hear what you're saying, but I also feel like we can't carry guilt, you know, because that doesn't help anyone, feeling like the could've's and the should've's. But what we need to do is hopefully, and what this is doing is changing culture, and shifting culture, meaning opening that door to talk about things that we don't have not felt comfortable talking about previously. Certainly not in my family growing up. My sister and I have diagnosed my father with Asperger's. He's never been officially diagnosed, but that's our diagnosis. And I say that because we've always known, you know, that he wasn't like the other dads. And it was never something we spoke about in our family. We never talked about that. We never spoke about it, you know. But you feel it, and you see it, and you experience it, and you know something's different, and why isn't he like my neighbor's dad or whatever. Still love him for all his quirky ways, but you know, this is, for me, it's about the unsilencing now, and I really feel like at least the next generation, especially with the way we talk online, but the youth of today feel like this. They're so much freer to speak, and hopefully that will also mean that we can talk about this. Hey, I'm not feeling well. I'm really depressed. I'm going through a lot. I have a song that I'm going to share with you guys now called Like Water, and I never performed this song because I hate it. I mean, I hate sharing this story, and I don't really talk about it. Somehow it came out 10 years ago when I was working with Marta Gonzalez and Quetzal Flores and produced the album. And I would never write personal stuff. If you listen to my album, it's all social justice, it's all, you know, school and prison pipeline and, you know, and divine feminine, and the streets. But I don't ever take it inside and tell about my personal story. We didn't ever talk about sex in my house growing up. We didn't talk about consent, affirmative consent. My first sexual experience was with a guy way older than me who was really abusive, mentally abusive, and would put me down a lot to the point where I lost a lot of self-esteem, didn't have any friends, and finally gave in. Like, I've never shared this before publicly, ever, but I got to the point where I said, okay, just get it over with, and that was me. Having sex for the first time, which I've never shared. So So I wrote a song, it's called Like Water, and I'm sharing.
Sometimes the cycle continues unless we help ourselves and recognize, you know, recognize our struggles, and work to finding healing and helping others, then the cycle just continues.
Yeah. We were asked to talk about art activism, we call ourselves artists, our relationship to each other. I'm just wondering where we should go next. Well, are there any questions for you? Can I open it up?
Yeah,
I mean,
we can.
How did you meet?
I was interviewing him, actually.
Her first question was, do you have a girlfriend?
No, that's not true. Back home in Australia, other than being an MC, I had a radio show, I had a hip-hop show that I presented and produced, and I was also a TV presenter, like a VJ. And he was an indie artist on Stone's Throw, and I really liked his stuff, and I wanted him on my show, so anyway, that's the first contact.
And she was, you know, that was the first national television show, national radio show I've been on, was her program, because it was all across Australia. So to have that kind of visibility for a super indie artist was great. And when she came to the US, she interviewed me again. I thought that was weird.
And he happened to be free all day and all night on Valentine's Day. So.
All day.
I was asking his schedule, and he was like, and I'm free all day Wednesday and all evening. And I was like, oh, that's not that thing. Anyway,
so we've had the opportunity to share our careers and the art that we make and create with one another.
And I think our music is our therapy. Would you say that?
I would say the music is definitely a therapy, because I get to put some of the feelings and anxiety or anger or and love into the songs, and then you get to hear it and you get to be like, is that about me?
And then I write a diss track. That's why I love hip hop, and yeah, tell it like it is.
Yeah.
Make some noise if you think art is therapy.
Be sure that we were in the right space to then care for, you know, two little hearts that would be added to this world. And I think that was really important for us to do. It helped in a lot of ways. But yeah, we consider ourselves artists, and so we use our music, our celebrity, our philanthropy, or income for philanthropy, and creating messages that hopefully are transforming, you know, society, making positive transformations. And so I got lucky enough to be part of this major music industry where every once in a while I write a song that becomes popular. And when that happens, I take the opportunity to then use the music video to tell a story that can help, you know, help to open a discussion, further a discussion, and tell a story of humanity. So the next song that I sing is a song where I had the opportunity to work with the National Day Laborers Organizing Network from headquartered here in Los Angeles.
In the long,
to create a visual story about humanity through the lens of immigrants. Immigrant family from Mexico, day laborers who are coming to find opportunity to make money, to raise their family, and to have dignity.
A better life. I mean, I'm an immigrant twice. I was born in Mexico, moved to Australia, and now I'm here because of you. But it's, you know, when my family, that's the truth. But when my family moved from Mexico, my mom was like, I wanted you guys to have the best opportunities, the best education, and have more than what we had. And that's all it is, right? And who is anyone to say no, you're not allowed? Who is anyone to stop a person from fleeing violence and living in a place that is not safe for them or their children?
I'm first generation American. My parents are from Panama. And Panama did not have a Martin Luther King. They did not have a civil rights movement. And if you're black in Central and South America, it's not all good. So they moved here to North America, to the United States, and they were able to offer better opportunities to their kids than, you know, family members who stayed back. And, you know, there's a real relationship that we have to the story of immigration, and that's why I use this music video to tell the story. You'll probably recognize the song, and hopefully you understand why I used this megaphone of a song to tell the story that I thought was really important.
So check out his version of the video, and happy birthday, Malcolm X.
Yeah.
Well,
it's so important to reground and to take time and to breathe, to get into your body. I'm learning this whole stuff right now about, you know, obviously we need to fight, we need to get active, we need to vote. Yes, right? That's the power that burns. Yes. But we also, and we have to shout it out, but we also have to take care of ourselves. You know, and make sure that we're mentally healthy, that we're looking after our little precious ones and being, you know, in a way that I don't even, well, not in a way, we don't talk to our kids about what's happening. You know, when there's a shooting, they don't know that because they're 5 and 3 years old, and I'm trying to preserve their childhood and let them just be free and be a child for a few years before the weight of the world gets on their shoulders. That's how I approach mothering right now. That's all I know right now. And I think it's so important. They will be woken up one day for sure. It doesn't need to be when they're 5. That's how I feel about that. But I hear you about the abortion laws happening in Alabama. I mean, it's horrible.
There's a lot of...
We can write songs about it.
About many different states. And part of it is challenging this paradigm of patriarchy. It's in our, it's very, very present in all of our media, in all of the music that my peers are making, and that so many levels of decision makers are checking off and putting out into the airwaves. It's in television media and the internet media, and not that there's, I'm advocating for a system of censorship of art. It's a matter of consciousness, of a heightened level of consciousness in terms of what is available and how we're processing it, right? If you are what you eat, then you also are what you hear, and you are what you see, and you are what you do. These are all the ways that we consume and that we become. So my goal is to, and our goal always is to challenge that by creating messages and narratives that can be hopefully a counterbalance to the very heavy weight of the material that's out that I don't necessarily agree with, but you know, I can't necessarily censor either. And then just trying to find ways to make it available to the appropriate audiences at the appropriate time. And that's the way I can answer that, because coming from the seat that I sit in, I feel like this, the position I hold is to try to offer a different narrative for my peers and my audience to hear, so that they're not always getting the junk food, sometimes they need home cooked meal.
And we also founded a company called Artivist Entertainment, along with Quetzal Flores, Alberto Lopez, and Veronica Gonzalez, the 5 of us founded it a few years ago. And we also produce events and create spaces where we can talk, where community can come together, where we can share ideas, where we can dream. We utilize the collective songwriting process, which is all about the process and the act of just being in community, being with one another, which I think is also extremely important. connect with nonprofits that already exist and support their endeavors. For instance, I'm part of a collective called Rise to Reunite, and they're a group of immigration their mothers are also immigration lawyers and other community members who are raising money to support Aloe Blacc, who do work down the border, but not just on this side, but also in Tijuana and in Central America. So, you know, it's also about supporting other organizations, Peace Over Violence, which is LA's longest running rape crisis education and prevention center here in downtown LA. We connect with nonprofits, TIA, who support refugees. So I think it's also about, you know, supporting people who are doing the work, connecting with these community organizations, COFA, Community Coalition in South Central, you know, all doing amazing work and connecting art with community organizing, you know.
Yeah.
It's so important.
It's important. We have the megaphone, we have the ears that are listening, and so we just, at every opportunity that we can, we bring our voice to the fight. And we will continue to do it, and thank you for bringing that up. We're going to be thinking really hard about it. And she's the one to do it. I mean, she wrote a song called Never Said Yes, which is literally about affirmative consent. I remember trying to give you a lyric, and you were like, nah. We don't need men to do this one. And you're like, okay.
Flipping the no means no. It's about, no, my consent is not implied until I say no, right? That's what learning no means. Like, you just waiting for a no, but no. It's a no until I say yes. So, anyway, I think our work here is done, Mr. Aloe Blacc.
Well, our work is never done, but we want to thank you for your...
We want to make space for Miguel.
We want to thank you for your time and attention, and thank you for... We rise for having us.
Evan Greer over here on percussion.
Really happy enough for you.